So in this area, it was very difficult to vote. You could take, you could be retaliated against, economic retaliation, other things. I was a student during this period, and many of the people active in the movement were students about my age, 19, 20, 21, that age. And what we reason why we called it a freedom struggle is that our struggle was not simply to get to end segregation and to get the right to vote, but also to bring about other changes, more economic changes in the United States. I was a student at the University of California in Los Angeles at that time, and our main goal was to get equal employment opportunities, because the way we felt about it is that if you didn't have enough money to go to the restaurant, it didn't matter whether you had the legal right to go there if you didn't have any money to spend. So we were much more concerned about employment issues. In Los Angeles at that time, there wasn't segregation in public places. So the main issues were economic, and some of those issues are still with us today. Martin Luther King, I think what made him distinctive among Black American leaders was that he was what I would call a visionary. He saw the connections among movements throughout the world, including the movement against colonialism. I don't think it's an accident that the major victories of the movement in the United States, these civil rights legislation in 1964 and 1965, happened about the same time, during the same period after World War II, when 50 countries throughout the world gained their independence from colonialism. There were a lot of connections among these movements. We borrowed tactics, for example, from the Gandhian independence movement in India. Many of the people I knew had been trained to use nonviolent tactics that had really been developed in India, and also practiced in places like Ghana. So of course, Gandhi himself got his start in South Africa. That was where he first developed his own nonviolent tactics. So there were a lot of interconnections among these movements, both in the United States and in Africa, which Martin Luther King always pointed out. He always had, in his speeches, he always referred to the connections between the movements against colonialism and the movement against racism in the United States. Also, Martin Luther King attended the independence celebration in Ghana in 1957. And that was very important to him, that he was at the independence celebration of the first nation south of the Sahara to gain its independence. And he was, of course, a good friend of Kwame Nkrumah, who at that time was the main leader of the Ghanaian independence movement. So we also felt a connection, and some of our leaders, like Martin Luther King, Malcolm X, of course, and by the mid-1960s, this connection was more obvious to people in the United States. For example, we read a book by Frantz Fanon, The Wretched of the Earth. How many of you are familiar with that book? Not very many, I guess. Well, it was a book written by a psychiatrist who was very much involved in the movement for independence in Algeria. And that was a very influential book in the United States. By the mid-1960s, many people like Malcolm X were traveling in Africa at the time when many African nations were gaining their independence, and this connection was much more obvious. For example, the first time I left the United States in 1967, I not only went to Europe, but also to North Africa. And I think many black Americans have made that a similar trip and made those connections. So so I think that part of the importance of Martin Luther King is that he symbolizes this connection among freedom movements. And one way of looking at this, the similarity and goal, is that during that time, the majority of the population on Earth gained basic citizenship rights. Rather than being the subject of a country you were in, you were actually, at least legally, a citizen of that country. So I think the movements since the 1960s have been, in large part, what does that mean? Answering the question, what does that mean to be a citizen of a country? Does it just mean that you can vote? Does it mean that you are actually involved in determining the destiny of that country? I think these questions are still with us today. Does citizenship really have a meaning? Many people obviously died for the right to citizenship. But after that goal was achieved, many people looked around and said, well, you know, I'm not any richer than I was yesterday. Do I have opportunity as well as rights? Do I have anything worth voting for? Or are elections just a fraud? So I think these are the questions that maybe might be asked in all the countries that gained their independence, as well as the United States. I think one thing that comes up in my classes is that I ask students, did you vote in the last election? And some of them say, no, they didn't. And I say, well, people died to gain you the right to vote. Why didn't you vote? And then they might answer, well, there was nothing worth voting for. And that bothers me, because I think that there should be something worth voting for if people died to get the right to vote and the right to be an equal citizen. So I think that Martin Luther King, one of the reasons why I didn't call our movement a civil rights movement, and I don't consider Martin Luther King simply a civil rights leader. If he were simply a civil rights leader, he would have stopped in 1965 when the last major piece of civil rights legislation was passed in the United States. But instead, the next year, he moved into a very poor area of Chicago and began struggling for other kinds of things, jobs, better housing. And of course, Martin Luther King, at the end of his life, was in Memphis, Tennessee. There he was involved in a struggle to gain economic rights by sanitation workers, people who pick up garbage. They were involved in a strike to gain better wages. And they asked him to come to Memphis and take part in that struggle. And he came there during the spring of 1968. And it was in Memphis where he was assassinated. So for me, when I think of Martin Luther King, I think of him not simply as a civil rights leader, but as a person who was very concerned about what he called the triple evils of the world. One of them was racism and racial discrimination. The other was poverty. And the final one was war. And he was very much involved in the campaign against American participation in Vietnam, in the Vietnam War. This was very controversial for him, because when the nation was at war, to be publicly opposed to the war was not a very popular position. But he felt that the United States, by entering the war in Vietnam, was continuing the effort of Europeans to dominate Asia. And he felt that it was a wrong war. And I think most Americans now would agree that that was not a well-conceived war, and we should not have been involved in it. So I think that when I look at Martin Luther King, I look upon him as a leader of a freedom struggle that had lots of different aspects, not simply the struggle for equal rights, but also a struggles that extended beyond the United States. He felt that poverty was the major problem in the world that he wanted to address in his last years when he launched what he called the Poor People's Campaign. So in 1968, his proposal was to come back to Washington and have a major protest again, but this time it was against conditions of poverty. And he was involved in that campaign, the Poor People's Campaign, when he was assassinated in Memphis. So with that background, a little bit about my own personal background, I'll just say that about 20 years after the March on Washington, Mrs. Coretta Scott King, Martin Luther King's widow, called me and asked whether I would edit and publish the papers of Martin Luther King. Since that time, my main task has been to assemble all of Martin Luther King's papers and publish them. You can go to our website, the Martin Luther King Research and Education Institute at Stanford. We have a wealth of information about Martin Luther King and the freedom struggle in the United States. And we also have many educational materials that you might find useful there. Also, about three decades after the March on Washington, I was involved in designing the Martin Luther King Memorial in Washington, D.C. And if you ever make it to Washington, D.C., I hope that you go and see the Martin Luther King Memorial there. The final thing I would mention is that I've been involved in making many documentaries about not only the African-American struggle, but I was one of the main advisors for a documentary series about the anti-apartheid struggle against apartheid in South Africa. So all of these indicate my own background. I wrote a play about Martin Luther King, which I had the privilege of watching it performed in China in 2007 by the National Theater of China. And I also brought that play to the Palestinian West Bank about 2 years ago. So I've seen Martin Luther King perform not simply by Black Americans, but by a Chinese actor, and by a Palestinian actor. And to me, that experience of watching Martin Luther King performed in different languages has heightened my awareness of his international significance. So I don't want to dominate the conversation. I would much rather have you ask anything. If I can't answer a question about Martin Luther King, I don't think anyone in the world can. So I would like to give you the opportunity to ask whatever questions you might have, and then I can find out more about you and what you're curious about. So I don't know. Let's see. I think I can see most of the sites where people are watching this. So if someone has a question, I'd welcome a chance to respond.
Thank you, Professor Carson. That's a very interesting history and experiences that you've shared with us. You know, what the civil rights movement meant, African Americans, and what drove the movement. Perhaps let me see whether we, you know, we have, you know, out of what you've said, whether we have in areas where, you know, our audience here or in Kikwe would like to get clarification or even questions or comments. Do we have anyone that would like to ask a question or that would like to share thoughts or comments? you know, from what Professor Carson has said? Yes, please.
Can you go ahead?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. I wanted your opinion as you described the whole movement, it's not a civil rights movement, it's a freedom struggle, right? So I need to understand that, in your opinion, do you think that the fact that it's in a way streaming going on today, do you think that Martin Luther King's legacy was lived, was successful, or is going to be successful? Do you think that there needs to be more of the movement or more of the struggle, more emphasis, more study, more involvement? What would you be your opinion on that?
Thank you for that question. That goes to the heart of what I want to say, and that is that if Martin Luther King had not been assassinated and were still living today, I am convinced that he would still consider himself to be in the struggle. Because, as I pointed out, he thought of the struggle not simply for civil rights, for equal civil rights, but as a struggle against poverty. Poverty is obviously still with us. He felt that there should be equal opportunity to gain economic success. And obviously he was involved in the struggle against war on an international basis, because he understood how destructive war was to the hopes and dreams of people. When he said, "I have a dream," some Americans think, well, his dream was realized. But I think if he were here, he would say, some of my dream was realized, but when I can walk and see homeless people, when I can still see people who lack employment opportunities, can't go to college, that the dream is still unfinished. And I think that the people who carry on his legacy are the people who are still in that struggle. And I think even with respect to citizenship rights, I think Martin Luther King meant much more than simply voting was involved with citizenship. That he took seriously the notion that every human being in a democracy has a right to participate in determining the future of the nation. And my own feeling is that democracy is not top down, it's bottom up. That it has to be, people have to be actively engaged in citizenship, not simply when it's time to vote, but more importantly, in between elections. If you simply look upon citizenship as this passive activity of, well, once every few years I go and vote to see who are going to be the leaders, and then in between the election, say, okay, they're the leaders, they decide. And I think, and Martin Luther King, I would say Martin Luther King felt that citizenship had to be a more active process. That if you wanted to be a citizen, you had to be actively involved in determining the future. And that all questions are open. So I think those kinds of things, if Martin Luther King were going around the world today, those are the things he would be talking about. Is the struggle is not over. I think that we gained important rights. Now, if you don't have the right to vote, then you have no say in the future of your country. But once you gain the right to vote, that's simply the starting point.
Thank you.
Dr. Carson, can you give us some examples of how to stay involved as citizens? You're talking about continuing to be involved as citizens between elections, and that's not just about voting. What are some other examples of ways Dr. Martin Luther King would have wanted us to be involved as citizens?
Well, one of the things that I think determines a democracy is what happens at the local level. Are there democratic processes at work in your neighborhood, in your city, in your university? Or is it simply top-down? I think democracy has to mean everyone being involved in, the way we put it back in the 60s was, everyone has a right to be involved in decisions that affect your life. So if someone is making a decision that affects your life, you should be involved in it. Now, trying to implement that is sometimes difficult, because democracy takes time. It takes time away from studying other things that you might want to do. But I think that if you're not involved, you're simply a subject of decisions made by other people. And so I take that very seriously, and I know that in every country, including the United States, as I said, some of my students say they don't vote. So they're not even doing the first part of citizenship, which is the right to vote. But the right to vote should be, or they only vote when there's a presidential election. They don't vote to see who is going to be the mayor of a city, who is going to be a governor of a state. They think that these elections don't mean anything. So I think that that kind of engaged citizenship is something that we're still learning about. The way I look at it is that we've got a lot of young democracies around the world. We've got old republics and young democracy. And what I mean by that is the United States as a republic is over 200 years old. I would argue that as a democracy, we're only about 50 years old. It's only been 50 years that everybody had the right to vote. In your country, it's about the same thing, only about 50 years since you gained the right to basic citizenship rights. 50 years is a very young time for a democracy. We don't know whether democracy is going to work. In many parts of the world, it hasn't worked very well. We have dictatorships, we have other forms of government where people have very little say in how they're governed. So I think that we're still working on this concept of democracy. And it's going to take some time to figure out. I think the first thing you have to have to make a democracy work is a basic level of education. If you're not literate, it's very difficult to actively participate in democracy. And gaining basic literacy is a struggle. I was in India and several times, and unlike China, where you have widespread accessibility to free education, in India they're still working on that, and many billions of people don't gain basic education. In the United States, that's still a problem, that sometimes we have a much better public educational system, but at the college level, it's more restrictive. So I think that these are the kinds of things you have to have basic education before you can be an active citizen. And that's a work in progress in many countries.
Thank you. Let's see whether we have questions from our two other points, the top about the children. Do we have any questions from Mindolo, CBU?
Hello, CBU here.
Yes, we can hear you.
Yes, we've actually posted a question on the chat. I don't know if... Yes.
Can you read it down? Oh, okay. Right.
Let's see if I can...
Okay. Professor Carson, can you see it?
No, I can't see the question.
Okay, I'll read it out. It says, nonviolence protest largely depends on the ability to mobilize a common feeling among a considerable size of people to push for a people power action. Now, the question is, how possible is it now to mobilize people in the world who mind their own business for an effective nonviolent action?
Yeah, I
hope you got that.
Yes, I did. Okay. How do you mobilize people? Well, one of the problems, I think, I've always resisted using the term nonviolence, because you're trying to define something by what it is not. A lot of things are nonviolent. You know, eating a meal is nonviolent. It simply says you're not using violence. What we meant by nonviolence is what I would mean by democracy. Nonviolence is a way of conducting democracy. Because if you are an engaged citizen, what you do is nonviolent, because you are engaged in trying to determine your own future. And you have a right to do that. In the United States, one of the first parts of the Bill of Rights, which was set up at the beginning of the country, was the right to protest. Martin Luther King often pointed out that protest is the most American thing you can do. That's how the country gained its independence from England, was through protest and agitation. Now, the revolution that created the United States also had a violent side. And I think that when you look at any mass movement, including the Black American movement, you find that there's a small minority engaged in violence. Some of you might be familiar with the Black Panther Party, which was not one of the elements of our freedom struggle, but they really weren't that involved in violence. They were trying to achieve self-defense, and they felt that that was a basic right. But I think that there are so many tactics that have been developed throughout the world. What nonviolence is, basically, is how do you get the attention of those in power and get them to listen to you? And that sometimes involves protests, it sometimes involves marches, sometimes there's a clause in the American Constitution and the Bill of Rights that says the right to assemble peacefully to gain redress of grievances. That if you have a grievance against the government, you should be able to assemble peacefully and protest. And that's nonviolence. So to me, nonviolence has been the tools that have been developed over the last 200 years to allow people who don't have enough power. If you have power, you don't need as many. You can achieve a change in government by simply getting the government to resign because you have the power. If you don't have the power, then you use other tactics to get the government to listen to you. And so that's what the March on Washington in 1963 was. It was a nonviolent protest. We wanted the American Congress to pass civil rights legislation. That's why we came to Washington to protest. We came to the National Mall, where on one end of the mall there's the Capitol, where Congress is. We were at the other end of the mall having 200,000 people protest in order to tell Congress we want civil rights legislation. And eventually the Congress responded to that. But if we didn't have the right, you know, if when we went to Washington to have our protest if we had simply been greeted with guns, I might not be here to be talking to you. Actually, when I went to the March on Washington, I didn't tell my parents, because for their generation, they feared that something bad might happen, that I might be arrested, or I might be beaten up by the police. I was pretty confident that that wouldn't happen, that I would be able to engage in the protest. But sometimes that does happen. So we were trying to use, so that's why I have the basic problem with that term nonviolence. It defines what it's not, but it doesn't define what it is. Nonviolence is something that developed at the grassroots level. There's a tactic called the sit-in, which students my age engaged in. And the idea of the sit-in was very simple. We would go into restaurants that were segregated, where Black Americans were not allowed to eat, and we would sit down in the restaurant, and we would simply refuse to leave. So that's why it was called a sit-in or a sit-down tactic. And it put the authorities in a very difficult position, because we weren't doing anything wrong. We were just sitting there. But it also put pressure on the owners of the restaurant, because if we came in and took all the seats, they weren't going to make any money as long as we were sitting there. So it turned out to be an effective tactic. Sometimes we would get arrested. I've been arrested before. But many times they would react with confusion. They would just close the restaurant down, which was fine with us, because that meant that the restaurant wasn't going to be serving any meals that day. So I think that these tactics were, and no one, the first students to use that tactic, they didn't know what they were doing, really. They were just protesting. There wasn't even a name for that tactic yet. But they simply decided they had to do something, and that's the tactic they chose. And then it became a very popular tactic among students.
We have another question from American Corner Mindolo, that is related to corruption and youth. I'll read it out.
Okay.
You say that you speak to many students that do not vote. Don't you think corruption is a major enemy to democracy, and what is discouraging youth from voting? I think that's a two-part question.
I think corruption is both corruption and fraud, dishonesty. One of the things that discourages people from voting is when people run for office and they tell you one thing, and then when they are elected, they do something else. So that creates a very cynical attitude among students. You know, why should I vote for this person? They're just going to make a promise and then get elected. And that's why I think it's important in between elections to remind people. If democracy, the word means rule by the people. But if people have the attitude, well, this person is in authority, my job is to simply obey authority, that's the wrong attitude. To me, the attitude is, this person in authority works for me. I hired this person, I could fire this person. And if you have that attitude, then you become more engaged in the process. I always argued for bottom-up rather than top-down. I think that too often we put our faith in leaders rather than put our faith in ourselves. I remember just one last thing on this. I remember the day before President Barack Obama was inaugurated, I gave a talk and I said, the most important day is not tomorrow when we inaugurate the first black president. The most important day is the day after tomorrow. Because if we think that simply by electing a black president our problems are going to be solved, then we've lost. And I think that that's the right attitude to take, is that yes, we elect our leaders, but we hold our leaders accountable. I think I saw another question someone was going to ask.
Well, I think so. Let's see whether we have any female members of our audience here. That's better questions. Do we have anybody, any female with a question? Yes. We'll get to you first, and then the gentleman in front, after her. Yeah, please go ahead.
Yes. From the presentation.
Sorry, Professor Carson, can you hear the question?
I can hear, I can't see the person.
Yes, from the presentation from Dr. Carson concerning the depth of acting, Martin Luther King. Don't you think, in your opinion, because Martin Luther King was at the forefront in the civil activism to fight for the black rights, don't you think there was maybe an invisible hand somewhere to silence his vision connected to his death?
I couldn't quite hear the question. Could you repeat it?
I think the question was, don't you think that there was an invisible hand to silence Dr. King's activism? The struggle for civil rights, right? Yeah. Was there an invisible hand to try to, you know, to stop Dr. King and the other civil rights leaders?
Oh, of course, yes. There were many leaders of our struggle who were assassinated or put in jail. And I think that, to me, a measure of whether a struggle is having an impact is sometimes the people in authority do listen to you, but their response is to try to stop the protest, try to stop the complaints rather than changing their behavior. So, yes, Martin Luther King, for example, was investigated by the government, and his phone was tapped so that they could find out what he was doing. Now people are very ashamed of this, you know, that this happened during his lifetime, that he was often persecuted, and of course he was assassinated in the end. But that's part of the price of struggle, is that sometimes people in authority listen to you, sometimes people in authority, they listen to you, but they don't like what they're hearing, and they try to stop it. That's just the nature of authority. And I think that it's not easy to be an engaged citizen. It's not easy to participate in the decisions that affect your life. It's much easier to simply go along with authority. And that's what most people want to do. But I think that that's not learning the right lesson. If the struggles of the 1950s and 60s that gained independence and brought about laws, if the result of that is simply, okay, now we are citizens and we just kind of listen to those in authority and we just do what they say, then we haven't learned anything.
Thank you. Before I get to the next person here, let me just read you one person from that has come through from CBU, Commonwealth University. It says, war crimes against humanity And most of the cases that African leaders, such as Charles Taylor, are charged with. What is your take following the massive violations of human rights in Iraq in form of counter-terrorism activities? Why has this not seen Bush? I think that relates to President Bush. And Tony Blair to the head.
So the question is, why are crimes against humanity not punished?
Well, the question is related to terrorism, right? And war crimes. Crimes against humanity and the war in Iraq.
Yeah.
So the question is, what is your take on the massive violations of human rights in Iraq in form of terrorism activities?
I think that one of the problems we face in the world, and it gets back to our original discussion about civil rights, is that one of the reasons why I prefer the term human rights to civil rights is that usually when we say civil rights, we mean that the nation state or government is responsible for defining what those rights are and protecting those rights. But what do you do if the government is the one that's violating those rights? What do you do if you have a nation that violates basic human rights? I think that we still have that problem today of how do we hold governments accountable? Governments are supposed to be protecting our rights. But sometimes what do we do if they violate a right? What do we do if they engage in genocide? What do they do if they, do we have international laws that hold governments accountable? That's a problem we're still trying to solve. What happens if you have a president of the United States who violates laws? Now, in the United States, that happens when the only response that we've had is to impeach the president. That has to be done by Congress. So what if that's not successful? We had one president, Nixon, back in the 1970s, who was removed from office because he violated the law. But that was a very difficult process to achieve. Right now, I think that we don't have a strong way of protecting human rights. I believe that every person on earth should have some basic human rights. But who is going to protect those rights? I think every person on earth, actually, my own belief, this is one of the things I gained from participation in a freedom struggle, I believe that every person on earth has a right to move every other place on earth. Now, that's difficult to imagine now, right? You know, that you could simply move to another country if you wanted to get a better job. But I think that there will be a world like that in the future. I think in Europe, it's already the case that if you live in the European community, you can go elsewhere in the European community to find a job. You can live other places in the European community. I think there will be a time when the entire world will be that way. But that will be a very difficult process. Because right now the rich countries do not want the poor people of other countries moving there. And that's an issue that we still have to deal with. I think also there will be a time when war crimes will be prosecuted. And people will not be able to get away with committing war crimes. they will be prosecuted and thrown in jail just like any other criminal. But we still are waiting for that day. I would say we're not waiting for it, we have to struggle for that. When people will be held accountable for crimes against humanity.
Thank you. We have about 15 minutes left before the end of our discussion. So let's see whether we have very complete questions. Very short questions. Very simple questions. Very complete. I love you. And you had your hands earlier on. Who else has a question? You'll be next.
I want to ask, apart from Martin Luther King, what are the names of the other leaders who also fought for the black voice, apart from Martin Luther King? Because I know he wasn't the only person. There were other leaders who also followed him and who are with him, even in Washington when he did the speech. So what are the names of those who are with him, that the other leaders?
That's a very good question. In my scholarly work, I have focused on not on Martin Luther King only, but on what I call grassroots leaders. These were the leaders who initiated the struggle and sustained the struggle at the local level. And many of them, their names, people like Fannie Lou Hamer, many of them were women, by the way. And often we give Martin Luther King credit for things that he was not responsible for, just like we give other leaders throughout the world. There was one of the most crucial movements for Martin Luther King was the Montgomery bus boycott in Montgomery, Alabama during the 1950s. That's the movement that made Martin Luther King a well-known leader. But I often say that there would be no Martin Luther King if there wasn't a Rosa Parks. Rosa Parks was the leader in Montgomery, Alabama, who refused to give up seat, but she was asked to move to the back of the bus. She refused to do that. She was arrested, and that started a boycott of the bus. The entire black community of Montgomery stayed off the buses for over a year before the policy was changed. So Martin Luther King became the spokesperson for the movement. But in my view, Rosa Parks made Martin Luther King possible. Martin Luther King didn't make Rosa Parks possible. In the same way, one of the most crucial victories that Martin Luther King achieved was in a city called Birmingham. But the local leader was Fred Shuttlesworth. So Martin Luther King got credit for the victory, but Fred Shuttlesworth made possible that victory. He was the one who was, Martin Luther King was not from Birmingham, he was an outsider who came to Birmingham. Fred Shuttlesworth was a native of Birmingham. So he was the one who initiated and sustained the movement. So much of my scholarship has been about what I call grassroots leadership. And I mean by the grassroots, people in local communities who often are the crucial elements in a struggle that attracts the attention of a person like Martin Luther King. Martin Luther King, one of the things that he did is that because he was a great speaker, Fred Shuttlesworth could invite him to come to Birmingham, and people would come out to listen to Martin Luther King speak. So I think that there was a way in which these local leaders interacted with the national leaders like Martin Luther King to create a movement. I think we still have time for maybe one or two more questions. Or?
Yes, we do. Please go ahead.
If we're saying that, looking at the life of Martin Luther King, we can see that he was a charismatic leader. He had a lot of people following him. The cause that he was fighting for was a very good cause. And I heard that at some point it was successful. The cause was successful. So I was just wondering, why did he take a political stance? Or is it that he wasn't just a politician? Because I think that some other issues, if he took a political stance and then maybe ran for office or something, other causes would have been quickly accomplished. Why did we have to wait for 40 years to see a black man ascend to the office of president?
Well, I think that, to me, any freedom struggle has stages. Barack Obama would not be president of the United States if we hadn't got to the stage of getting the Voting Rights Act of 1965. Because most white Americans did not vote for Barack Obama. About 43% of white Americans voted for Barack Obama. So how did he become president? Well, he became president because many people who could not vote in 1965 were able to vote when he ran for president. So he could win a minority of the white vote and still become president. So I think that movements come in stages. If you don't have basic human rights, it's difficult to imagine becoming president or any other office. So I think that Martin Luther King and people like Fred Shuttlesworth made possible Barack Obama. Just this week I had Jesse Jackson come to my class and give a lecture. Jesse Jackson ran for president. He was a black leader of the freedom struggle. He ran for president in the 1980s, 30 years ago. But he was unsuccessful. And when I introduced Jesse Jackson, I said, here is the man who made possible Barack Obama. Because if he hadn't run for president in the 1980s, 30 years ago, Barack Obama would not be president. So I think that we'll never have a single struggle, and at the end of that struggle, you'll turn around and say, I live in a perfect nation that has perfect justice. There was one of our freedom signs that said, freedom is a constant struggle. And I think that's true.
Thank you. I think we have time for one more question. I want to ask this, Professor Carson, for some of the questions that would not be able to answer today, that have come through, can we send them over to you and then you give us your responses, or send them over to our audience?
I would encourage everyone who wants to contact me. I'm pretty easy to access through email. You can just send me an email. My email address is ccarson, two C's, A-R-S-O-N, at stanford.edu, S-T-A-N-F-O-R-D, period, E-D-U. But you can find me, if you search for my name using Google or whatever you use, I'm easily found. Sometimes I think I'm too easy to find.
All right, thank you.
I should say, ask me short questions when you email me, because My rule is that if I can't answer a question in 1 minute, I don't answer it, because I get several hundred emails a day. So if I spent many minutes answering every email, I would never get any work done. So try to make your questions very specific.
Right. Thank you. So the email address, I don't know whether you can read it on the chat box there. It's ccarson@stanford.edu. Okay? Ccarson, C-A-C-S-O-N, @stanford.edu.
And I've also tried, and you can look at I have several websites, and I've tried to put as many of my writings online as possible. So, nearly all of my books are now available, that you can download them. You can get the electronic version of the book. For example, I have a book called The Autobiography of Martin Luther King. It's a very good source of material about Martin Luther King. And it's available in audio version. It's available in electronic version. And it's available in many languages.
Right. Thank you. We'll have the last question before we wrap up. Somebody with a hand here. Okay. Go ahead.
When you look at America today, would you say that the fact that now America has a black president has in any way helped achieve what Martin Luther wanted to achieve, as in compared to the previous administrations that had white presidents?
I think that the election, one of the reasons why I went to the inauguration of Barack Obama is that I felt that this was a major victory for the struggle that I was involved in. But as I said, I did not have any expectation that because he was a black president, other countries have had black presidents. That didn't mean that they became suddenly perfect countries and that they solved their problems of injustice. So I tried to be realistic about what even a president can do, and realize that he was not going to, and he said this before his election, he said, I'm not going to be the black American president, I'm going to be the president of every person. So I think there were some black Americans who felt, oh, well, we now have a black president. He's going to do things that are going to specifically help the black community. Sometimes he does. But that's not his job. His job is to be president. And, so that means that he's going to engage in some things that I don't approve of. You know, for example, I don't approve of drone strikes, where you send drones to kill people. So if I were talking to him, I've had very limited opportunities to talk with him, by the way. But if I were going to talk with him, I would say, you should stop that. But other things that he's done, I very much approve of. I think it's a source of pride to have a black president. And also, and this is something that's not mentioned very much, he's the son of an immigrant. That a African man can have a son who becomes president of the United States. I wonder how many nations in Africa would elect a person not only who is basically the son of a person from another African country, or would people vote for someone who's not of their same group. You know, it's, you know, I think we face that problem throughout the world. And it, so it's not that surprising that most white Americans did not vote for Barack Obama. I think it's remarkable that 43% of them did. I think that indicates a willingness to change and a willingness to accept leadership from someone else. When I think back over American history, there was a time when I don't think 1% of white Americans would have voted for a black president. So these are the kinds of things that change. Would your country vote for a white president?
There is a white vice president in Zambia, Professor Carson.
Yeah, and that indicates change. You know, that indicates a willingness to look beyond race.
Right. Thank you so much, Professor Carson, for your time and for sharing your experiences, your thoughts, you know, about the civil rights movement. We actually have a list of some of your books, including the latest book that you've done. So we'll be able to share with our audience the titles here. Maybe they'll be able to get their hand on some of those books.
It's been my pleasure to talk to all of you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for your patience.
Thank you. Okay, so this is the end of our discussion today. Thank you so much for coming. We started late, but I think it has been an exciting discussion, and we would like